Giuseppe Verdi's life spanned the 19th century. He was born in 1813 and died in 1901, and he wrote 26 operas, half dozen of which are masterpieces and indispensable if you're in the business of producing opera. He was born in Laurentale in the Po Valley of Italy, land as flat as a pancake, but oh, how rich. Rich in music, too. It's the part of the world that also produced Stradivarius and Toscanini. There must be something in the earth and air. Laurentale isn't a crossroad. It isn't even a wide place in the road. I can remember only the church with its square tower looking taller than it really is because of the flat country around it. And the stone house where Verdi was born. It's so simple you wouldn't be surprised if it had a dirt floor like a barn, a stable. But it's actually pretty well built. And the room where the great man was born is on the second floor. The house was Verdi's father's sort of store, tavern, where the neighboring peasants came to get their staples and tobacco and wine. How could these humble surroundings have had anything to do with Rigoletto and Aida and Otello? As was usual in those days, Verdi's first exposure to music was in church. The organ is only one manual, one keyboard, and it only a few octaves, but enough to transport a boy to another world, that is, if he's a genius, by the name of Giuseppe Verdi. One day serving mass, he got so lost in the music, he failed to make the responses. The priest gave him a kick which sent him down the altar steps and left him unconscious and bleeding. Pretty soon, he moved on to the next town, Busetto, where he became director of the Società Filarmonica, the Philharmonic Society, a rather fancy name for the town band, which furnished the music for weddings and funerals and gave little Sunday afternoon concerts. The chief backer of the Società Filarmonica was Antonio Barezzi, the leading merchant of the town. And at 23, Verdi married the boss's daughter, Margherita. Milan was the next stop, and his first opera, his very first opera, was produced at La Scala. It wasn't a big success, but it had enough to land Verdi a contract from La Scala for three more works. He had it made, and then tragedy struck. Within 2 years, Verdi's young wife and two children died. On top of this, the second opera was a dismal failure. In his despair, he thought he could never write again, and he asked Morelli, the manager of La Scala, to release him from his contract. Morelli must have been the wisest of men. "I can't force you to compose," he replied, "but my faith in you is as strong as ever." And now comes the turning point. One snowy day, Morelli ran into Verdi in the street. He practically forced on him a new libretto. It was Nabucco, that short for Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon who conquered Jerusalem, but who wound up eating grass. Verdi himself tells the story. "Back home, I threw the manuscript on the table with an almost violent gesture. It had opened of itself. My eyes clung to the open page into one special line. Va pensiero sull'ali dorate. The paraphrase of the 137th Psalm. By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion." Giuseppe Verdi was at work again. Va pensiero became the great unison chorus of Nabucco, and it swept Italy. The Italians recognized in the plight of the Jews during the Babylonian captivity their own agony under the yoke of Austria. Verdi was the eye of the hurricane. His very name became a battle cry. "Viva Verdi," the people would shout and scrawl in public places right under the noses of the Austrian police, who hadn't the faintest notion what was happening. To his countrymen, the name of Verdi, V-E-R-D-I, was an acrostic for Vittorio Emanuele, Re d'Italia, Victor Emmanuel, King of Italy. "Down with the Austrians, out with the oppressor, Risorgimento," was the cry. "Unification for Italy." The soprano who sang the feminine lead in Nabucco was Giuseppina Strepponi. She'd been around, and was largely through her interest in young Verdi that his first opera got put on, and she figures more importantly in his life later on. After Nabucco, a dozen operas follow in rapid succession, and then come the three of the great middle period. In a span of 2 years, think of it, 1851, 1853, Verdi produced Rigoletto, a hunchback jester, Trovatore, a gypsy hag crazed for vengeance, Traviata, a consumptive kept woman. For the first time, the opera stage was inhabited not by strutting singers, but by living humans, people of real flesh and blood. For years, Verdi and Giuseppina Strapponi had been living together and finally were married. He was nearing 60. He'd all but retired to his villa, his farm at Saint Agata, near where he was born. He never lost his love of the land, and this was his favorite spot on earth. In 1869, a feeler came on behalf of a person of high station. It turned out to be no less than the Khedive of Egypt. The new work was, of course, Aida. Aida, which has had more performances and more opening nights at the Metropolitan than any other work. And Aida was not the final chapter. Past 70, Verdi produced Otello, and then the final miracle. At 80, he went again to Shakespeare and came up with Falstaff. Verdi's autobiography is only a fragment. He didn't write it until he was 66, and it stops with the success of Nabucco when he was 29, and remember, he lived to be 88. Not even the triumph of Nabucco could dispel his disillusionment. And the autobiographical sketch ends with one of those bitter Italian proverbs, fidarsi e bene, non fidarsi e meglio. To trust is good, not to trust is better. Franco Zeffirelli, the great director and designer, who's done both Otello and Falstaff at the Metropolitan, is something of the same type as Verdi, said of the old man, too wise to be generous. But Verdi was generous. He was a very rich man, and he put his money in the right place. His finest work, he said, was the Casa di Riposo, the House of Rest, the home for old musicians which he established in Milan. It still houses nearly 90 of these dear old people, some of them once big names in music. Each room has its own piano, and Verdi's guests, for the inscription speaks of the maestro's sweet hospitality, can spend their last days in dignity and peace. When Giuseppina died, Verdi couldn't stand the loneliness, the memories of St. Agata, and he moved back to Milan to the Grand Hotel. One morning he was dressing and dropped a stud. His niece, who looked after him, was out of the room, and he went after it himself under the bed and struck his head. A stroke followed, but he gave death a hard struggle. For a week, he lay unconscious. The Milanese lined the streets outside the Grand Hotel with straw so the maestro could go to sleep in peace. Unpretentious to the end, he'd set down the order for the brief, simple funeral at the morning or evening Ave Maria without music. One detail, however, he'd overlooked. He'd also dictated his wish to be buried in the chapel of the Casa di Riposo, and of course the grave had to be prepared. For the second funeral, the whole city of Milan turned out. 200,000 people lined the streets. Toscanini conducted the orchestra of La Scala in a chorus of 500. And what do you think they sang? Va pensiero sull'ali dorate, fly thought on wings of gold. The great unison chorus of Captive Israel from Nabucco. And that whole city took it up. Werfel says it was one of the great and rare moments when people and music become one. Here's the chapel today. In the pavement on the right is a great bronze slab with the name in big Roman letters. Two lines. Giuseppe Verdi. That's all. No dates, nothing else. By it, there's another slab of the same size, the same style of lettering. Giuseppina Verdi Strapponi, the extraordinary woman who shared his life for 50 years. On the left wall is a bronze plaque to that young wife and the two children whose deaths left Verdi convinced he could never write again. And over the altar is a line from the ode D'Annunzio wrote on his death. Piansi ad amo per tutti. He wept and loved for us all.